Welcome to Victory. I want to thank you for being a part of our Victory family today. Thank you for watching the program. I'm the senior pastor at Victory in Camden and Victory in El Dorado. We have campus pastors at each one of those, and we just want to thank you for being a part of our audience. Thank you for letting Victory be a part of your family and a part of your life. During the service today, there will be a telephone number at the bottom of your screen. If you would take advantage of it, let us know what's going on in your life. If God is dealing with your heart, if you're rejoicing in your heart, things that we can stand with you and pray with you about, call that number at the bottom of the screen. Let's go right into that service at Victory now. And a catalyst is something that's placed into other chemicals that causes the process to go quicker. And that's what the Lord has spoken to me about it. That some of the processes in your life, they got bogged down. Some of you have been believing the Lord for some things. You've been believing the Lord, I won't say for too long, but you've grown weary with it. And God wants to help you by putting a catalyst, something that God wants you to add to that belief, or add to your faith over it, or re-encourage faith. God wants to put a catalyst there, something that will cause that action to take place quicker. And so I'm going to be talking with you about some things that you can do. There'll be a catalyst to put into your situation that will cause it to happen quicker. How many want to happen quicker? How many want a quick move of God? How many would love to have a little quicker healing, a little quicker deliverance? How many like to have your family get straightened out a little quicker? God's able to do that. Man, God is able. Somebody say God's able. God's able to do that. Amen. All right, now, the first catalyst that the Lord dealt with my heart was God's going to restore honor. You've got to have a foundation of honor in your life in some degree. God's only going to build on foundations that have a sense of honor and a sense of respect in them. And I tell you what, it's a sad situation. Our society is sad when it comes to honor. I say we have a heartbeat for reaching children, but I'm amazed as when we reach children and there seems to be no respect in them at all. That means moms and dads have failed, communities have failed, towns have failed. But it all can start with me. I mean, we don't establish anything by God by pointing at other people. That's not the way God does it. God starts with something in me that God wants to do deeper that will be able to spread. Now, other nations that are seeing marvelous miracles are usually nations that have a degree of honor that we don't have here. I mean, we live in a nation where you talk back to policemen, you talk back to referees, and where you talk back. I mean, there's no respect. But God wants to reestablish honor and respect. And if God can do that, it'd be a foundation for God to build a miracle in our lives with. Amen. Now, God wants to reestablish honor in so many ways. God wants to reestablish, the first way is honor God. I would say honor God. Because that's the first four scriptures of the Ten Commandments had to do with honoring God. The number five had to do with honoring family. The second thing that God wants to reestablish honor on, God wants to reestablish honor in the family. Everybody say the family. And then the third thing God wants to establish, God wants to reestablish honor in the authorities. Authorities. You know, the Bible says that the laws of the land, they're ministers of God. And if you cannot honor somebody for their action, you can honor them because of the Lord. Because God says, they're my ministers. There are those that are established, the authorities, that are ministers. We've got to begin to honor them as ministers of the Lord. Amen. And they're civil leaders, and they're social leaders. And that's where those that I was just mentioning to you. And then the Bible says that we're to honor all believers. And there's a powerful scripture here that says that we're talking about God using it as a catalyst. That means if I can get honor working in my life to a greater degree, that means it will catapult my situation. It will cause my circumstance to go faster. It will cause the miracle deliverance to move faster in my life. I love this scripture, Romans chapter 12, out of the Passion Version. It says, be devoted, tenderly loving your fellow believers as members of one family. Try to outdo yourselves in respect and honor of one another. I love that scripture, don't you? Try to outdo yourselves in honoring people and in respect. That's all believers. Then the Bible tells us to honor everyone. I mean, you know, there's something that kind of goes cross-grain in our spirit. And that's when you see a real blessing happen to a scoundrel. I mean, somebody that has no respect for anybody. I mean, you're thankful for God blessing them, but it don't mix to you, does it? It's kind of like bitter and sweet all at the same time. But let me ask you, what happens when you watch the Lord bless somebody that is honorable, that's so respectful, that they live an honored life and they honor the authorities that God's put in their life? All of a sudden, you know what happens when you find out God's blessed them? A big smile comes across your face. Do you know why? Because it mixes right in us. It mixes right. Honor is to go with blessing. It's the Lord built us that way. A person that lives an honorable life is to be blessed. And that's what the Bible says. And then the sixth place of honor is the hardest of all. And this is to honor those who dishonor you. Callous number three is, God wants to move me into a high level of praise. God wants to use intentional praise in my life to change situations. Now, praise comes at all different kinds of levels. And we all know that. I mean, sometimes you walk in and praise is good, but it's good. And so you can sense the presence of the Lord. And then sometimes you walk in and you can sense God's presence in a much more real way. I mean, praise comes in all these different levels. Well, I really like the medium praise, because the medium praise is, and I love deep praise. I love that deep worship. When all you want to do is bow before God and worship and cry before his presence, I love that moment. But I learned in medium praise, you can use it for God's glory. In fact, God will use medium praise instead of you just praising or just seeing how you feel in praise or making judgment whether I feel like I'm praising this morning or not. Why don't you begin to intentionally take that praise service and put it into your situation that you're facing? You can make an intentional investment in your life and in someone you love's life or a circumstance that you're burdened for. Praise has the power to do that. So where that you can intentionally take praise. See, the devil has equipped us pretty good. I mean, I tell you what, I don't have to look very far to find a complaint over a hard issue I'm going through. I mean, I don't have to look hard to find that. The devil makes sure I think of that right offhand. I think about a complaint. But God says, if you will use high praise, the difference in praise and high praise, one is not only the level of it, but it's the intention. It's when you as a believer say, I'm going to intentionally use praise to change my situation. I'm going to use praise to turn this thing around. I'm going to use praise to release healing in my life. I'm going to use praise to change my financial circumstance. I'm going to use praise to release joy inside me. See, praise has the opportunity to do that. In fact, it's the book of praise that we find that it becomes the gate of the presence of God. Praise becomes the very gate into God's presence. So I can intentionally, I can intentionally use praise. Now, I'm certainly not talking about how you praise, because all of us are different in some certain areas. I mean, some of us are just naturally louder at praise than others. Some of us are more outward praise. Some of us are more inward praise. But I do believe, even if we're inward, because I have a real, my place of that I feel best is when I'm all inward. But that's not the place that God wants to bless me most of the time. Because God wants to bless me when I will make praise outward and I will intentionally take praise and place it in to various situations. So what I have to do is this. I have to, number one, short circuit the complaint. Everybody say short circuit the complaint. I got to short circuit the complaint, because the devil hooks me up with powerlessness through complaining. If I complain, I'll be powerless. If I complain, I'm moving the supernatural power of God out of my situation. If I complain, I'm taking the situation out of the hands of God. Praise identifies with the right hand of God. Now, the right hand of God, according to Scripture, is the power, is the hand of power. God has power. praise identifies with this right hand of God's power. That right hand of power, all of us believe in it. That's that hand of power that's able to move behind the situation. And when I can't see nothing changing, that powerful hand of God can reach into that thing and turn it around for the glory of God. That powerful hand of God can change people's thinking. They can change people, what they think about me, what they believe about me. They can change the way I feel. They can change the way, the favor that I have. That powerful hand of God. Now, the scripture says that the left hand of God is the blessing hand of God. It's what God extends blessings to me with. And I'm so thankful for that blessing hand of God. And I'm so thankful that God supplies all of our need according to his blessing hand that's able to come out. But I'm going to tell you what, not only does God have a blessing hand, he's got a powerful hand. And God has given me the authority in each of our lives as a believer to release that powerful hand of God. That's the hand that the Bible talked about in Romans chapter 8 when it said God is able to call all things. He causes all things to work together for a good. That powerful hand of God can literally turn around any situation, any life. It can turn around any family. It can turn around any view. It can turn around any finances. It can turn around any career. That powerful hand of God. In fact, the things that make it so powerful because it best works in impossibility situations. The powerful hand of God mightily is able to be used in situations that seem impossible to us. Because what seems impossible with my physical hand is powerful through his mighty hand that God's able to do it. Amen? So it's just real important, though, that God is wanting the high praises of God. High praises being intentional praise. Now, in the Bible, in Psalms 149, now I believe that God appropriately placed it in the right place, too. I mean, God just caught, man, the wisdom of God is just so, you can't understand it. It's just so deep. But the Lord placed, out of God's great workbook, or great book on praise, at the very close of it, Psalms 149, there's only one more chapter in the book of Psalms. God placed the secret of high praise. What high praise? Everybody say intentional praise. Where I intentionally take praise and put it into my situation. Somebody says, I could complain, but I'm going to choose to praise. I could get discouraged, but I'm going to choose to praise. I could feel down, but I'm going to choose to praise. I could turn around and run, but I choose to praise. I choose to praise. Intentional praise. Everybody say intentional praise. Intentional praise. Psalms 149 verse 6 says, God's high and holy praises. High praise. Everybody say high praises. The high, fill their mouths. You can circle that word mouth because that's the secret of it. For their shouted praises are what? Weapons of war. Now, when you look at the rest of the book of Psalms, you're going to find praise will do a lot of things, man. Praise will move God, praise will gain favor, praise will move angels. But here at the closing of God's mighty book of the power of praise, he says, now I'm going to tell you the secret of the most powerful praise. It's when you intentionally take praise and put it into your situation, then praise becomes a weapon against the enemy. That's what he says. Then verse 7 says, these warring weapons will bring vengeance. What weapons? Intentionally taking praise and putting it into your situation or your circumstance, intentionally taking praise, it will bring vengeance on every opposing force. Boy, I just like those words. Somebody just needs to sit up and let your breast just swell up, man. Oh, these are scriptures that we like. Man, these are scriptures that we like. Amen. The Bible says if I will intentionally take praise and put it into my difficulty, that it will bring vengeance on every opposing force. Everything that's trying to keep my miracle from happening, everything that's trying to keep God from rescuing me, everything that's trying to keep me sick, everything that's trying to keep me down, everything that's trying to keep me distraught, the Bible said praise will become an opposing force against that. High praise, intentional praise, amen. It says these warring weapons will bring vengeance on every opposing force and every resistant power. Everybody say every resistant power. It will bind kings. I tell you what, I am tired of that lousy devil trying to be a king in my life. I'm tired of that lousy devil trying to rule parts of my life that he has no right to. I'm tired of that lousy devil. And the Bible says that if I will do intentional praise into my situation that I'm going through, it will bind that rascal up and make him powerless, unable to bring that against me more. Amen. Now the Bible says, now verse 8 says, praise-filled warriors. Now that's what it is. A praise-filled warrior is a warrior that takes intentional praise and puts it into his situation. Now, David is known as the worshiping warrior. That's what he is. David is a worshiping warrior. You can go all the way back to Joshua. God told Joshua what his desire was and the land that was God, what God was giving to the children of Israel. God spoke that by way of promise. And even though Joshua was such a mighty man and a forerunner of Jesus, in fact, they ended up with the same name, still yet he was not able to conquer what God told him was his. Now, I don't know about you, but that's like reading a scripture and saying, by his stripes you're healed, and there you stay sick all the time. You understand? I have promises that I'm not able to conquer that territory yet. Just like God's promises of provision. And I got a shock the other day at this huge bill I got. It kind of took me back. You understand? And all of a sudden I realized I have a promise that's not what the promise says. The promise says, my God shall supply all of your need according to his riches and glory. But I hadn't conquered that yet. But somebody say, it's not over yet. All the day's still not over yet. The sun's still up, honey. I still got time to conquer for the glory of God. Now the Lord spoke to Joshua and told Joshua what God had given to him. But Joshua wasn't able to conquer it. And then after Joshua, it went into a whole line of judges. For hundreds of years, men tried their best to lead God's army to finally conquer what God had promised them. So, honey, don't feel bad if you find a promise that's not in your life yet. You've got a host of people. You're in good company, what I'm telling you. Because there's a host of people. For hundreds of years, the people had the promise, but they had not conquered it. Until a worshiping warrior walked on the scene. And when the worshiping warrior walked on the scene, because he knew the secret. The secret wasn't in his power. The secret wasn't in his might. The secret wasn't in him being able to accomplish it himself. His secret was, I will praise God. I will intentionally praise God in my difficulties, and God's hand of power will bring it to pass for my life. And that's why he wrote it at the conclusion of his book. You understand? Because David was the first king to conquer everything that God told him was his. Give David a hand, would you, for the glory of the Lord? Because he was able to conquer it. Now, I want to leave you today with one story. I really need, because there's five stories that you need to be aware of that you need to have in your arsenal if you're going to be a worshiping warrior. If you're going to be able to deliberately, instead of complaining, instead of running, to deliberately take praise into your difficulty and watch praise release the powerful hand of God and change that. There's at least five stories in the Bible that you need to have. You need to have understanding to them. The first one is, you need to have an understanding of Jesus and Lazarus. Because there are things in your life that will die that you will need to bring back to life. And you need to have the understanding of why Jesus himself, the first thing he did was offer praise. The first thing he did was not begin to try to work a miracle. The first thing that he did was to offer praise. And he said, Father, I pray so they will hear me. And Jesus began to give thanks and praise to God. And honey, whatever it is that's dead in your life, that needs to live again, God's given you the power to bring it to life. Be a worshiping warrior. The second story that's found in John chapter 11, verses 41 through 43. And the answer to it, Jesus rekindles life into that which has tried to die. Shall these dry bones live? Yes, Lord, they'll live. They'll live, Lord. They'll live. They'll live. They'll live. And some people have a love that's trying to die. Some people have relationships that's trying to die. Some people have finances that's really trying to die. Some people have careers that's trying to die. But God's put within your power the power to become a worshiping warrior. To finally conquer what Jesus told you was to be yours. The second story is the story of Paul, found in Acts chapter 16, verse 23. Paul and Silas were in stocks. They were put in the dungeon. The situation was dark. There was no power in the flesh that they had that could change that situation. The third story we need to have. The third story, we all need to have the story of Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat is found in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Powerful, powerful story. You need to read the story how King Jehoshaphat got it one morning. He was totally surrounded. There was no way out. Everybody say, there was no way out. You know, that's what cancer verdicts try to give you, is no way out. That's what heart attacks try to give you, is a no way out. That's what divorce tried to give you, is a no way out. But God's able to make a way where there seemeth to be no way, for the glory of God, for a worshiping warrior. And the Bible said that Jehoshaphat did not know what to do. But I love what he said. He said, because my eyes are on you. The fourth story that you need to have. The fourth story you need to have in your arsenal is you need to understand the power of prayer, or the power of worship, when it comes to fighting battles, as it was with Moses and Aaron and Hur on the mountaintop. There's a powerful truth that's revealed in that process. Joshua was down in the valley. Joshua was fighting the Amalekites. He had his sword drawn. He was fighting them, him and the army of Israel. But they could not prevail. But there came a man who was able to climb to the top of the mountain. I'm going to tell you what, if you're going to be a praise warrior, you got to climb up out of that discouragement. You got to climb up out of that that's trying to push you down. You've got to climb. There came a man that climbed to the top of that mountain. And the Bible said every time he would hold his hands up, God would empower the works of Joshua, and Joshua would prevail against the enemy. God's restoring power of blessing to the worship warrior. And that one's found as you see in David. When David was restoring the ark of God back to its rightful place. David tried in his own flesh. He went out, he got all of these, he got thousands of soldiers, of guards, and he made this beautiful wagon, and he said, this will surely bring the presence of God. This will surely work this thing out. God wants to help us just as he helped David. And there at the close of the book of Psalms, when David penned, he said, now let me show you the real secret of praise. How to take high praise and cause high praise to be a weapon that will bind the devil. Let me tell you how to take praise to be a powerful weapon to stop the enemy that's fought you for so long. Take praise and intentionally place it into your difficulty that you're going through. And that praise will change that situation and do a supernatural miracle for the glory of God. Can you say amen?
I believe the Holy Spirit has touched our life today. I believe that the words that were spoken, I believe God is dealing with us. And for many of us, maybe we need to make some things right with God. Maybe there's some areas of our life that we need to surrender to Him. Maybe there's some things that the Holy Spirit is asking us to come over or come out of. Can I pray with you? Can I pray with you and ask God to forgive us? Can I pray with you and ask God to help us to surrender those areas of our life? Can I pray with you and ask God to help us to be able to change things through His power, to be able to live differently, talk differently, think differently, and be different? God can help us do that. That's all in the areas of God's strength and His power, is to help us live a victorious life. Let's pray. Would you pray and say, Father, forgive me for my sin. Forgive me for my failure. And Lord, I ask you to come in my life. And Lord, right here today, I ask you, God, that you would be Lord of my life. And Lord, in the issues of my life that I need to surrender to you, the areas of fear and discouragement, the things that's caused me to be depressed and those things that's hit hard on me or those things that's tried to come into my life and overcome my life, Lord, I come today to surrender them to you. I know that you're able, God, to free me, to help me. And Lord, I surrender them in Jesus' name to you. And now, Lord, I ask you for your grace and for your strength to overcome. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Call that number on the bottom of the screen. Will you call us and let us hear from you? Will you let us be a part of your support team? Let us be a part of that team that's going to be praying with you and standing with you and believing God with you. And also on the website, let us hear of your prayer request. God bless you. And I pray that this week will be the strongest week in the Lord you've ever had. Look forward to it next week. God bless you. Hi, I'm Pastor Jerry Abrams. Thanks for watching Victory Today. Victory is a church that's all about people, all about excitement, all about what God's doing in your life. We want to invite you back to watch each week for another exciting time together. To find out more about Victory, give us a call and let us know how we can be a part of your family. God bless you, and thank you for watching the program today.